Good morning and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church in Tuscaloosa. So glad you have chosen to join us today by television or live stream for this worship service. We remain in broadcast-only mode, which means once again that this service was recorded a few days ago. So to keep up with the latest news from the church, please consult the church's email prayer list that has come out. Also, check our website or social media. We are in broadcast-only mode for Sunday morning services, but we are going to have another in-person worship service this evening as we continue our In the Garden prayer worship services that are in the evening. It begins at 6 p.m. in the Rose Garden. Everyone who comes will be required to wear a mask and to remain sacredly distanced throughout the service. It provides an opportunity for worship and prayer, but also informal but responsible fellowship with one another. This evening service will include the baptism of infant Ford McNeil, son of Burns and Virginia McNeil. Again, hope you will attend this In the Garden worship prayer service tonight at 6 p.m. There are many ways to connect, grow, and serve with us at First Presbyterian Church, either in person or virtually. Many groups are meeting virtually now through Zoom. But also know that any church group can call the church office and reserve outdoor space, like in the Rose Garden, for example, for a masked, sacredly distanced meeting here on the grounds. You can also help neighbors in need in a variety of ways. You can help pack and distribute food boxes for folks impacted by the pandemic on Mondays and Thursdays at Beulah Missionary Baptist Church. Check the church email to learn more and to sign up. You can also distribute hand sanitizer to area nonprofit agencies and nursing homes, or serve at the community soup bowl, or you can knit a blanket to welcome new babies. In addition, Presbyterian women continue to collect for the PW pantry. Items needed for the coming months are laundry detergent, bleach, combs and hair brushes, bottled water, and boxes of cereal. You can purchase these items and set them aside until Monday, September 21st. That is the drop-off date here at the church outside right on Greensboro Avenue. Again, see the church email for more details. If you are a rising freshman in college, please apply now for the Alex Powell Scholarship through First Presbyterian. You need to apply by August 18th. More information can be found on the church email. And thank you again for all who continue to give to the church financially during these difficult times. Since we cannot pass the offering plate this morning, we would encourage you to go to our church website and click on the blue Give Now button, so that you can give electronically. And of course, you may continue to mail in your checks through the mail. Please know how grateful we are for any of your gifts. Next Sunday, August 16th, we will have a blessing of the backpacks during the morning worship service. Children, students, teachers, professors, moms and dads who work, have your backpack or book bag ready for the 11 o'clock worship service online. During the word for the children, we will have the blessing. You can find a bulletin for today's worship service on the church website. So now, let us worship God.
Friends, please rise in body or in spirit for our call to worship. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth.
Sing the glory of God's name. Give God glorious praise.
Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Because of your great power, your enemies cringe before you.
All the earth worships you. They sing praises to you. Sing praises to your name.
Come and see what God has done.
God is awesome.
Thank you.
Friends, let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we lift up our voices in songs of praise, struck by your unlimited awesomeness. Fill this space and hour with your presence, so we might emerge ready and willing to meet the week ahead with the confidence of your chosen people. With this same confidence, let us continue to serve you with reverence and thanksgiving, always trusting in the one who says, "Do not be afraid." It is in your name we pray. Amen. Scripture tells us that Jesus says, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me. Out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin as we pray. O God, when trials beset us, it is natural to fear. But we now confess our fears have led us to sink into sin. Called to be courageous, we find our faith lacking. When asked to take risks, we confess our complacency. When faced with uncertainty, we panic and overreact. When given ample reason for hope, we choose to doubt. Lord, you have shown us how you are a God to be trusted. Leading your people, you have stayed by their side. Forgive our reluctance to believe in your providing and protective hand, and grant us the faith to reach out and grab it. Amen. Scripture tells us that no one who believes in Jesus Christ will be put to shame, that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Trusting in this steadfast promise, we rejoice knowing that God forgives us. Friends, hear and believe the good news. In Christ, we are a new creation, and in Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Knowing that we are a forgiven people filled with God's grace, let us share a piece of this grace with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Peace, Luann.
Peace, Andy.
Peace, Suzanne. Peace, Matt.
Peace, everyone.
Peace, friends. Oh. Oh gosh. So sorry, boys and girls. I was caught up. I was thinking about a question. And before I ask you that question, let me say that It is so good, and I'm so glad to have the opportunity to spend time with y'all this morning. And I was thinking, and I would like to know if any of y'all have felt brave and scared at the exact same time. And I know that sounds a little confusing, but I would like to share with y'all a story about a time that Jesus' best pals felt brave and scared at the exact same time. So they were in their fishing boat on a lake, and all of a sudden the weather got very stormy. And Jesus wasn't with them. He was spending some time alone in prayer on the shore. And out on the lake, you know, like when the wind starts to blow and the waters get choppy and you get these huge waves. Well, that happened, and the waves got bigger and bigger as the wind blew faster and faster and faster. And this poor boat, there were these massive waves slamming into the side of the boat, and the rain began to lash down, and oh my gosh, what a frightening night. Can you imagine what would have happened if the boat capsized? What if somebody drowned? That would have been terrible. Well, Peter and Andrew and James and John and the rest of Jesus' pals, they were pretty good at fishing, and they were pretty good at sailing. I mean, they had been caught in a storm a few times before, but they couldn't swim. So if they ended up in the water, who knows what would have happened. So just as soon as they thought they could handle the boat and keep everyone safe, another huge wave rose up and knocked them down. And it just felt like the boat might tip over. Can you imagine? Can you think of how better this night would turn out if Jesus were with them? And then on top of this storm, on top of everything that's going on in the midst of the rain and the lightning and the thunder, somebody screams out, "Oh, no, there's a ghost out there." Someone was in the lake trying to get to the boat. Whoa, wait a minute though. It wasn't really a ghost. It was Jesus. And Peter felt so brave, or maybe he was so scared, or so brave and so scared all at once, that he jumped out of the boat and tried to reach Jesus. But oh no, remember, he can't swim. A big wave tossed him up into the air, and he got a mouthful of gross, icky, salty seawater. And just as he was trying to shout out, "Help!" Jesus was right there beside him, grabbing his arms and pulling him toward the boat, and huffing and puffing as everyone reached over the side and helped him and Peter tumble back into the boat and thump. Just as they landed safe on the deck, the wild wind died down and the lake grew calmer and calmer until the boat was hardly moving at all. Just kind of sitting there on still water. While Peter turned to his pals and they wondered how Jesus had felt when he came to find them right in the middle of a storm. Jesus, they thought, must have felt very brave tonight. But he must have been really scared too. All in all, they were just very glad that in all the feeling of braveness and all the feeling of being scared, Jesus really cared about them and had come to help. So whenever we're feeling brave, or when we're really scared, or when we're feeling very happy or feeling sad, no matter what emotion you might be feeling, Jesus is always ready and always willing to come help. Let's say a prayer. Dear God.
Dear God.
We thank you for the times that we feel brave.
We thank you for the times we feel brave.
And even when we're scared.
And even when we're scared.
We thank you for sending Jesus.
We thank you for sending Jesus.
To come help us out.
To come help us out.
We love you, God.
We love you, God.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, boys and girls, we'll see you next week.
As we approach God's word, let us pray. God of our present trouble and promised triumph, open our eyes to see you in the midst of our struggles. Open our ears to hear your words of invitation and assurance. Open our minds to recall your wonderful works and miracles. Open our hearts to glory in your name and seek strength in your word. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading is from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 14, beginning with verse 22. Listen for God's word. Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, Jesus went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, Jesus came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, Peter cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In a few minutes, we will sing the doxology as we do most Sundays. I want to talk with you a little today about the doxology. I even considered singing it to begin this sermon, but decided against that. You're welcome. But what are we doing when we sing the doxology, and what does that word mean anyway? Doxology comes from the Greek words doxa, meaning praise or glory, and logia, meaning word or oral expression. So it is an oral expression of praise or glory to God, specifically in response to God's goodness. You see something that gives witness to God's love, power, creativity, mercy, what have you, and you are naturally moved to respond with words of praise. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. That's doxology. It's a natural, unforced response of praise and glory. Thanks be to God. That's another one. And just a moment ago when you learned I was not going to sing the doxology, you said, thanks be to God. That's doxology. When you're moved to give thanks and praise to God. Another way you might say it is when you're moved to worship and wonder in response to an expression or realization of just how good God is. That's doxology. In today's scripture lesson, we see a choice between two destinations that the episodes of life often lead us to. One is worship and wonder, and the other is fear and doubt. Which path do we choose? The one that leads to worship and wonder, or the one that leads to fear and doubt? Here in the bright light of Sunday morning in church, or at least in church mode, it is easy for us to say, worship and wonder. But it's not that easy, because we don't always know when we are making these choices. And it is difficult to choose the path of worship and wonder over fear and doubt when we are making that choice in the midst of a great storm. A storm plays a prominent feature in our lectionary scripture lesson this morning. Following the miracle of the feeding of 5,000, Jesus sends his disciples in a boat on ahead to the next town they were going. But he stays behind to just get away by himself and spend some time in prayer. It is on this boat ride that the disciples experience a battering storm. But now, before we get into the story of the disciples and the storm, I want to just look for a moment at the example that Jesus sets for us. He sets aside time to be alone in prayer. He has just been busy doing ministry, and he knows he has more coming up, so he knows he needs to stop and spend some time with God, recharging his battery, resetting, refocusing, centering himself before he moves on to the next thing. This is such a critical task and practice that we must make note of. And all the more when the duties are great and must be carried out in the middle of a storm. I read something years ago that has influenced me a great deal. I read that when the storm rages, you need to pray more, not less. What that has meant for me is that when I have a really heavy day in store. For example, when I know that in a day I need to write a sermon and prepare for a big committee meeting and then meet with the family to plan for a funeral and then run up to make a hospital visit in Birmingham, making phone calls all the way there and back, and somehow preserve some energy for my family who needs me when I get home. When I am having one of those days, when I see one of those days is coming, I am so tempted to say, well, I'll just cut back on my prayer time today because I got enough to do, and I'll make up for that lost prayer time some other time. You know, in reality, I need more time in prayer on those days, not less. When the storm rages, we need more prayer, not less, because time alone in prayer helps us to reconnect with God and regain perspective. It helps us to be closer to our best, which we need all the more as the storms of life rage on. Refreshed, Jesus leaves his time of prayer to catch up with his disciples. The boat they are in is caught in a great storm, so the scripture reports that Jesus begins walking to them on the water. When the disciples see him walking to them on the water, they're all terrified. "It's a ghost," they say in panic. "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid," says Jesus. And then Peter, impetuous Peter, act first, think second Peter, then jumps out of the boat, starts walking to Jesus on the water. But then Peter notices something. He notices the wind and the waves and the dangerous, unpredictable situation he is now in. And what happens? He begins to sink. Jesus reaches out and catches him, thankfully, saving him, saying, "Why did you doubt, O you of little faith?" They then get into the boat. The wind and the waves cease, and the disciples break into doxology. "Truly, you are the Son of God." Just a couple of observations about this story, because this story is our story. It plays out in our lives too. Are we not just like the disciples, full of fear, focusing on the wind and the waves, and quick to interpret any new information or development, or let alone change from the norm, in the most pessimistic way? We are captives to fear. We are motivated too often by fear and doubt, and not enough by hope and optimism and worship and wonder. And the whole world knows it. Look at the ways people and institutions and industries are trying to motivate, shape, and influence our thinking, our believing, our behaving, our spending, our voting. They are doing so with explosions and blood and fear and fire through all kinds of far-fetched, fear-driven scenarios. We are just like those disciples in the boat. Jesus shows up and we scream, "It's a ghost!" That's because we just saw a TV commercial saying, "Have you seen ghosts on the water? They're here to steal your children and take your guns and make you wear a mask. So vote for Representative Manly Man and he'll get rid of those ghosts." Now, Peter's part in this story makes it even clearer the choice we face. When Peter focuses on Jesus and his power, promises, and presence, what happens? He walks on water. And what happens when Peter takes his eyes off Jesus and starts focusing on the wind and the waves and the dangers and all that could go wrong? He begins to sink. Fortunately for Peter, Jesus is right there to save him as he is sinking. N.T. Wright, in his commentary, points out how very important it is for us to notice this dynamic. The moment when we are most strongly tempted to give up and give into fear is probably the moment when help is, if only we knew it, just a step away. Jesus does not wait until the storm is over to come to his disciples. He comes to them right in the middle of the storm, right when they need him most. But because of the fear, the wind and the waves, they don't at first recognize him. I wonder how often this happens to us. We're in the middle of some storm, heartache, or crisis, and Jesus comes to us, and nothing will stop him from coming to us. He walks on water, to get to us if necessary, to be with us in our time of need. And when he arrives, we shun or dismiss the one whose presence, whose teachings, guidance, and love could be that which saves us. Now, Jesus, after catching the sinking Peter, says, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" This statement has often, I think, been unfairly interpreted as if Peter is some sort of horrible, faithless person. But we need to remember the greater context in which this statement is made. Peter is on this missionary journey with Jesus because he has faith in Jesus. He's in this boat in the middle of this storm because Jesus asked him to be. He's not some horrible, faithless person. He is, like the other disciples, one who just panicked in the middle of a time of uncertainty. He might not be all that different from you or me. Beverly Gaventa writes, "This is not the story of the skeptic who habitually doubts, but the story of the faithful follower who becomes overwhelmed by the circumstances surrounding him, who begins to lose his nerve when he discovers the odds stacked against him, but who from Jesus finds a steadying, delivering hand." If that is the definition of a person of little faith, then mark me down as one of those. Maybe a few of you might feel you qualify as well. The disciples, they panicked. Peter, he panicked. They knew what Jesus was capable of. They knew of his power. They had just witnessed the feeding of the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. But this storm, with the wind and the waves, the dangers and the unknowns, it got in their heads. It rattled them. It consumed their attention. It filled their vision, such that they almost missed the one who showed up to save them from it. We know this situation. We are in this situation. We are living through a storm right now, and it is battering us thoroughly. We have not seen a storm like this in generations. So what do we need to get through it? Today's scripture lesson would suggest we need to try to be at our very best, given the difficult circumstances. We need to reconnect with God in prayer. And please do not hear that as some sort of moralistic appeal. You say your prayers. No, I mean, we need to reconnect with our foundation, with our Maker. We need to center ourselves, regain lost perspective by remembering the eternal perspective, God's perspective. And as the storm rages on, we need to keep our eyes fixed on the one who embodies that eternal perspective, whose life demonstrates how we are supposed to live ours. We need to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus and his power, his love, his witness, his ability to work in and through the good, the bad, and the ugly, in through all kinds of amazing, transformative, miraculous, life-saving ways. If we can do this, if we can make these choices to pray, to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, then we at least have a chance. We have at least have a chance of making it through the storm. We have a chance to avoid being pulled under by the fear and the doubt, we have a chance to be like those wet and weary disciples who were filled with reason for worship and wonder, for true doxology. Truly, you are the Son of God. To God be the glory. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Church, having heard God's word read and proclaimed, let us respond reciting the Apostles' Creed, answering that age-old question, what do we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Because this service was recorded earlier in the week, you will find today's prayer concerns in the daily email prayer list, which is being sent out. Knowing that we are never beyond God's reach, we lay our hopes and fears before the Lord. Let us pray. Lord God, as we navigate strong headwinds and seek to see you through our fatigue and fears, we confess that you are truly the Son of God, the Savior of the world, the one who stills the storm and immediately reaches out your hand to keep us from drowning. We rest for a moment in the joy of your presence, no longer afraid, free from anxiety, assured that you do not leave us alone, but seek us out when we are most in need of your peace. We know, Lord, that none of our thoughts and hopes, our doubts or worries are off limits to your care and compassion. We know you welcome us as we are and hear whatever is on our hearts and minds. We ask you to hear our prayers for those in our midst most battered by the storms of our time. Grab the hands of those about to go under the waves of poverty or financial crisis. We ask for your intervention on behalf of families unable to provide basic necessities for their children, our siblings wrestling with food insecurity, those on the cusp of eviction, and the unemployed facing the end of benefits. As we see those about to be swamped by the waves of this pandemic, move us to act in ways that lift others out of the roiling sea. Reach out and give courage and strength to people in leadership positions. Grant them wisdom to make decisions in the best interest of the most vulnerable. Inspire communities to use their power and resources, their will and gifts to support the people on the margins, those for whom this difficult season has been catastrophic. We pray for teachers, administrators, parents, and students as they all seek to navigate a new school year rife with uncertainty and unprecedented challenges. We are mindful of essential workers who are facing the danger of this public health crisis every day. Protect and sustain them, Lord. We lift up the sick and all those who suffer. Give them hope. Bring relief. Surround them with your mercy. Quiet the dangerous winds of discord and division and stir up the breath of the Holy Spirit to heal and unite us. Help us to build up the body, strengthen our witness, and reveal to the world that we follow the one who commands us to love one another. May others look at your church and see your hands and feet at work in the world, feeding and tending, forgiving and repairing, doing justice, loving kindness, and walking humbly with God. In this moment, Lord, we rest in your presence, certain that you are our Savior and the Savior of the world, able to do abundantly more than we can ever hope or imagine, never far from us, always reaching out your hand to save us when we fear the wind and waves of life will overtake us. We praise you as we pray the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God gives us that which is good, the gift of community, the gift of creation, the gift of new life in Christ. We can in no way repay God for all of God's goodness towards us, but we can respond with gratitude, giving joyfully a portion of what God entrusts to our care. So in thanksgiving, let us worship God with our morning's offering. Let us pray. Generous God, we thank you for your call and claim upon our lives, because there is so much more we can become and so much more we can do. We pray that our doubts will decrease as our faith increases, that our practice of generosity will grow large, and that our joy in believing will encourage others as we share with them the good news of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Well, as you continue your journey through this strange time, I encourage you to choose the path that leads to worship and wonder. It won't be easy, particularly as the storm rages on, but I think you will find it will be worth it. And you might even find yourself saved because of it. I also charge you as you go to remember that you go not alone. By the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ walks with you every day. He goes above to protect. He goes below to support. He goes in front to guide. He goes behind to encourage. And remember that he walks beside you, because above all, he loves you. Knowing this great love, let us therefore go in his name, spreading the good news until we meet again. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest upon and remain with you and those you love, both this day and forevermore. Amen.